sunrise, reflecting off the dew. The tiny prisms sing out a song of you. I see the river awash in dazzling spray. All nature worships the one who made the day. So here's my song to thee, O God of majesty. Though I can't even sing like a lowly sparrow, my trembling voice I raise. I want to join the praise. I lift my joyful soul, the one that you made whole. The crash of thunder resounds across the hills, and all of you, Lord, within my heart instills. The vibrant meadows aglow in vibrant bloom. May I reflect them, whose simple theme is you. So here's my song to thee, O God of majesty. Though I can't even sing like a lowly sparrow, my trembling voice I raise. I want to join the praise. I lift my joyful soul, the one that you made whole. Just simple harp strings brought forth a melody. The little shepherd, he sang his song to thee. No symphony to sing, just a song on silver wings. Oh Lord, how lovely the humble song to thee. So here's my song to thee, O God of majesty. Though I can't even sing like a lowly sparrow, my trembling voice I raise. I want to join the praise. I lift my joyful soul, the one that you made whole. Shadows fall all around us. Darkness comes to hide our way. Don't despair, soon night is ending. The clearest sky will greet the day. There's a brighter day a-coming. Even in the blackest midnight, I have a lamp to guide my way. For the light of God's Son shines in my heart. He turns the darkness into day. There's a bright. Brighter day
Acts chapter 22. For those that I haven't been able to meet before, I'm Dave Beyea from Old Time Baptist Church in Hamburg, New York. Been serving with Pastor Lou Guadagno, and our preacher just went to be with the Lord. And so I've been serving with his son, and it was pretty neat to be able to see that Pastor Lou Jr., he's not really a junior, but the way to be able to decipher the two, you state that, Junior was in my youth group, and him and his brother Pete both been in my youth group, and now they're pretty much my boss, and so that's a blessing to be able to be around long enough to be able to know that, to see where God's brought us from, to be able to know the family history. When I was young, I used to run around Louie and Peter. At that time, when I was just a teenager, they were just little kids, and Pastor Lou wasn't even a pastor at the time, so it's neat to be able to have some history, be able to go back and be able to see what the Lord has done, what he's going to do. And there's some things that we ought to get excited about, some things that we be able to look at history and see what God has done in our personal history, how he's allowed us to be able to connect with others, and be able to see that God is doing something. Sometimes it gets lonely. Sometimes it gets boring. Sometimes it's like, ho-hum, here we go again. But God is doing something. I don't understand it all. I can't see it all. But I know the Lord is doing something. And I just believe that he's going to continue. And I just want to be available. I want to be ready for whatever he wants to do, wherever he wants to do it. And it's like, God, that's why I'm here. I'm here. Use me. And in Acts chapter 22 and verse 6, the Bible says, "And it came to pass that as I made my journey and was come nigh unto Damascus about noon, suddenly there shone from heaven a great light round about me." We know that this is a story of Paul and him giving his testimony of salvation. And so I want to spin off of that and be able to see what the Lord's going to have for us. Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you that you've given us a testimony. You've given us a reason to rejoice and be happy. We've got a reason to sing, not of only that which is yet to come, but we can look back and see what you have already done. And we're grateful for the salvation that you brought into our life, the change into our families, the hope of eternal life, the hope of life abundant on this earth, the victorious Christian life and that which is yet to come. And I pray that you'd help us to be able to reach out into our community and to our families and be able to see your name honored and glorified, that we'd be able to please you and be able to see lives changed and families reconciled. Lord, we love you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So we see that Paul is talking. He says, "And it came to pass that as I made my journey and was come nigh to Damascus about noon, suddenly there shone from heaven a great light round about me." Verse 10, "And I said, what shall I do, Lord?" That's a good response right there. Now, you know that God's speaking to you. Right there, I believe, is the whole thing. That's the Christian life. God's talking. We ought to be listening, and our response ought to be every time, "Lord, what would you have me to do?" Paul doesn't even know the Lord at this time. I mean, he's Saul. He's unconverted. Yet he had the right response. And verse 10, that's what I wanted to show there in verse 10. Verse 15, statement being made to Paul says, "For thou shalt be his witness unto all men of what thou hast seen and heard." What are we supposed to do? And the instructions from God through a man is thou shalt be a witness of what you have seen and what you have heard. And turn to chapter 4, Acts chapter 4. thought this was a neat connection. The instruction given to Paul, what his job is to do, of what to be a witness of what he has seen and heard. So in Acts chapter 4, Peter and John are getting rebuked. They're getting yelled at. They're getting in trouble with the law. And they say in verse 19, but Peter and John answered and said unto them, whether it be right in the sight of God to hearken unto you more than unto God, judge ye. For we cannot but speak the things which we have seen and heard. And what are the things that we like to talk about? The things that we have seen and heard. What is the most important thing that you've ever seen in your life? What's the most important thing that you've heard in your life? Don't you like to talk about it? I get energetic when I may be tired, working all day, and I'm ready to just hang it up, go home, and get away from it all. But then somebody just says something to me about, hey, can I ask you a personal question? And they ask me about salvation. They ask me about God. It's like, I just woke up. This is what I've been looking for. This is what I'm living for. I want to be able to talk to folks, to be able to tell them what God's done for me, and to be able to know what God has done in other people's lives, to be able to be connected with folks from around the world like we are, is tremendous. To be able to hear their testimony, to see what God's doing over in the Philippines, to see what God is doing in Papua New Guinea, to see what God is doing in Michigan, to see what God is doing in New York, of all places, and to be able to see what God is doing in our lives, and to be able to hear the testimonies. This is the things that encourage each other. And this is what brings people around. This is why people want to come around. They want to hear the good news. They want to hear that God's doing something. Not that he has only done something. You know, we're talking Memorial Day tomorrow. And Brother Nagalski was talking about things that have happened in the past. And we need to know what God has done in the past, because it gives us a sight, an idea of what is going to happen in the future. We don't want to fulfill what Brother Ruckman has said many times. You know, what do we learn from history? Nobody learns from history. We don't want to be those type of people. We want to learn from history so we can see what's going to happen in the future. And, you know, and there are many in our world, in our life, there are many people that we're going to meet, they really don't care to hear what the Bible has to say. And I've had people tell me that. Don't tell me what the Bible says. I really don't want to hear what the Bible has to say. And there's a part of me that says, well, I got nothing to say. But I've got their ear. I got the opportunity. And they say, I want to know what you think. Well, did you ever notice here in the book of Acts when Paul is giving his testimony? You and I now quote scripture that was his story. Prior to him giving these words, he wasn't pulling out of the Old Testament. He was giving his testimony, and now you and I quote it as scripture. God wants to use your testimony and my testimony to be able to influence other people for the cause of Christ. And God has allowed us to go through things. He's allowed us to be able to have that connection with him to be able to share it with others, because people will connect with us. And what did Paul say? Follow me as I follow Christ. Well, people need people to follow. They need somebody that they can touch, that they can hold, that they can see, that they can hear, and be able to connect with God. Now, if that's the way they always stay, there's a problem, you know. And when we have that opportunity to be able to connect with people, be able to show them a God who loves them and cares for them, and it's exciting to be around people like that, and they're thinking, they're asking questions, they want to be discipled, and they're reading their Bible, and they're praying, and they're finally getting answers to their prayer, and they're able to connect with God. That's exciting. And it just energizes you. It says, man, I got to search the scriptures even more. And to be able to have those answers that they need. What's the greatest day of your life? What is the greatest day of your life? Is there a day in your life that you can look at and be able to say, that was the greatest day of my life? Yeah. July 16th, 1980 was the greatest day of my life. I was 9 years old. And up to that point, my dad, he was a drunk. He was into drugs. He was a functional drunk. He was still going to work. My mom, she was a drunk. And I remember the fights that they used to have. We were Catholics. I was going to a Catholic school, good Catholic people. Catholic priests would even come over to the house. And, share a drink or two with my dad. And good friends. And a friend of my dad at work. A friend of my dad's at work. My dad's a drunk. Everybody knew who my dad was. They all knew he was a partier. He'd have the parties at the house. We had the pool, had the big Advent speakers, and had the party going on. But there's a friend at work saying, hey, Joe, why don't you come to church? Why don't you come with me to church? And you know how big our church was? It was so big, we fit in a garage. We fit in the pastor's garage. He went and converted his garage into an auditorium. Every room in his house became a Sunday school room. And I remember those days that we would go, and it took months and months and months of my dad's friend inviting him to church. And finally, my mom, I believe she got saved before we even stepped into the Baptist church. My mom, she was frustrated with the life. She was frustrated with the life that they had. But because of her upbringing, she didn't want to see the family ripped apart. And she sought the Lord. She went to a charismatic meeting and said, God ain't part of that. But she was encouraged to read her Bible, and she did. And after reading the book of John, she got saved. And through, I believe, my mom seeking the Lord, God used a friend at work to invite my dad to church. And 6 months of whatever, we would go to the Baptist church on Sunday night because we were good Catholics. And went to church either Saturday afternoon because we wanted to sleep in Sunday morning or whatever. And, we were raised Catholic. We went to church. We went to Mass. And we went through all those things. I believed in Jesus Christ. There were some things that I was taught. Jesus Christ died for me. He was buried. He rose again. But that leaven that they had in their doctrine is what ruined everything. But I still believed. I didn't know what to do with that belief. We went to the Baptist church, and what does a Baptist church do after every service, during every service? Do you know for sure you're going to heaven? If you don't know for sure, raise your hand. I'll pray for you. And I remember that one Wednesday night, after my dad got saved. My dad got saved on Father's Day. That was June 1980. And what a drastic change. We went home, and my dad, Sunday afternoon, went to the fridge, grabbed all his booze. My dad was 35 years old. He had been drinking since he was 13. That's when his dad passed away. And he became so unruly. At 13, he started drinking. And I remember my dad waking up in the morning. The first thing in his left hand was a can of beer. And right hand was a cigarette. Or at least that's what I thought it was. Every morning. We got home after church. He took all his booze, dumped it down the drain. And he's never touched it since. Amen. I mean, drastic change. And there's no more holes in the wall from the pots and pans and everything else flying around. And I remember those days. Amen. What a drastic change. A month later, July 16th, 1980, was a Wednesday night. Preacher's asking, if you don't know for sure you're going to heaven, raise your hand. I'll pray for you. He says, nobody's looking around. He lied. And so I raised my hand. He says, I'll pray for you. Well, the wife of the man who invited my family to church came to me and says, David, you want to know for sure you're going to heaven? And I said, yes. So she took me out into the hallway, met the preacher, and the preacher, I mean, I was just 9 years old, a kid, a little boy, and the preacher is 6'3", 6'4", and he was showing me the scriptures of how to be saved. Romans chapter 10. He said, David, do you know that you're a sinner? I said, yes, I know. And in my heart, the thought had gone through my head was I was in the Catholic Church. I didn't realize it was from going to the Catholic Church on Sunday morning, going to the Baptist Church Sunday night. Hearing the preaching of the Word of God, the Holy Spirit of God convicting me, I remember sitting on the front row in the Catholic Church because it was the only place that had padded seats. And the Holy Spirit of God convicted me right there and said, David, you're going to hell. The Holy Spirit of God, clearly. And I thank God for being so clear and so distinct with me. Yeah. To be able to know that the Lord was dealing with me. I was guilty. I knew what sin was. And the preacher had asked me, do you know that you're a sinner? I said, yeah. He says, do you know that you're going to go to hell when you die? I said, no doubt about it. And these are things that I was thinking because the Holy Spirit of God had convicted me and told me, you're a sinner and you're going to hell. And in Romans 10:9, the Bible says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. I believed it. Yeah. I believe that Jesus Christ did that for me. It's nice that he did it for the world, but he did it for me. And that's a stickler with me. When I'm talking with folks, you know, they like to say, yeah, Jesus died for the world. Like, yeah, but did he do it for you?
That's right.
This is personal, especially at that time of salvation. I mean, this is, be selfish. This is it. This is the time, you know. You got to get in. And the Lord really spoke to my heart. And at that moment, he says, do you believe that Jesus Christ died for you and that he rose again? And that he wants to forgive you of your sin. I said, yes. Before I even prayed, because he says, you know, right after that, he's like, well, why don't you pray and ask the Lord? Before I even prayed, I know I was saved. Because it wasn't a prayer. It's what you believe in your heart.
Yeah.
I believe that Jesus Christ loves me, and he cares for me. And he is willing to forgive me of my sins if I was willing to repent. And I was willing to repent. I was a wicked little boy. I was bad. And I see the struggle that some of my peers go through. The way they were raised is very similar. And I see the struggle in life that they have, and I can see what I could have been. Because I see where I was heading. I thank God for intervening in my life in more ways than just this one time of salvation. I'm telling you, God has been good to this guy right here. And not only do I know I'm saved, the guilt for my sin is gone. I mean, I felt so guilty. I felt so bad for my sin because I was raised to know that there is sin. I'm a sinner. I'm bad. There's a heaven. There's a hell. And hopefully you'll get to heaven. You know, go to confession, say your prayers. But maybe. I felt bad. You know, my parents made me feel bad. You know, they'd always remind me, you've done this all the time. You know, always throw it in my face. But God forgave me. I was the happiest little boy you'd ever meet. 9 years old, I was telling everybody how to get saved. And I remember going into my friends' homes and witnessing to their parents. And I invited all my friends to church. They're all riding with us. And we had stuffed the car full of people. And I remember going in their homes, changing all their radio stations to the Christian radio station. And I remember getting yelled at by someone, "Don't touch my radio." I was excited. I had something to talk about. I didn't know what to talk about, but I had something to say. I mean, God changed me. And I still feel the same way today. I enjoy it. Greatest day of my life. The greatest experience of my life. 2 Chronicles chapter 15. 2 Chronicles. This verse has become my life's verse. Because one day, I decided that sitting under the preaching of the Word of God, I was at college, I was going to State University, I wanted to be an engineer, and there's a lot of things that had happened from the time I was saved to this time now that I'm in college, and I wasn't like I was when I was saved, and so now I'm going to college, I'm on my own, my parents are not putting a requirement on me to go to church, I'm in a place, I don't know anybody, and so the Holy Spirit of God is working in my heart, and he used so many different things to draw me back. It's phenomenal to look back at it. It's so awesome to see that the things that were done at such an early age came back to me as a young man. The Lord used that to bring me back, and it's like, don't ever give up. Don't ever think that the things that we say and the things that we do in church, well, I don't know. So many testimonies I can give. But I'm in college. I go to church, and I only knew one name at this large church. I called up the church. They came out, and they picked me up. I go, and the preacher's preaching, and I don't know anybody. I've got one outfit to wear and one church outfit, my best to wear, and I'm wearing it to church. I'm going, I'm listening. And this preacher, I don't remember what he was preaching about, but he read this verse, and God used this verse to get a hold of me and challenged me. 2 Chronicles chapter 15, the Bible says in verse 2, "And he went out to meet Asa and said unto him, Hear ye me, Asa, and all Judah and Benjamin." And this is the phrase, "The Lord is with you while ye be with him. And if you seek him, he will be found of you. But if you forsake him, he will forsake you." I went back to my room and to my dorm. I was living on the campus of a state university. Wicked place of all places. And God's hand of protection was there. And God was working on my heart. And I went back to my room and I'm reading this. And I said, "Lord, you're not a liar. You're not a liar. I don't know you like I used to know you. I want to know you. You said that that you're with me while I'm with you. You're letting me take the lead on this relationship. I don't understand that, but I want you." And he says, "If you seek him, he will be found of you." So at that time, I made a decision. Verse 8. "And when Asa heard these words in the prophecy of Oded the prophet," notice this, "he took courage and put away the abominable idols." Continue on down. "And renewed the altar of the Lord." There are some things that we got to put away in order to find the Lord. And there are some things that we need to renew in our life when it comes to a relationship and a dedication to God. You find yourself at a place where you're not so close to the Lord. You find yourself at a place where the relationship isn't as sweet. Maybe we need to put away some things. Maybe some things come into our life and we got to put it away for such a time as this. It's not convenient at this time. We need to put it away. And the thing is, at this point in my life, God was more important to me than anything else. Now, I'm going to college. I'm doing the heavy-duty schoolwork, and I'm like, stuff I've never done before, and this is difficult. This is a struggle, and I'm by myself. I've got no support and that I can see there, and I felt all alone. I said, I made a commitment to the Lord. I said, "Lord, I'm going to seek you with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my strength. I'm going to do everything. I'm going to go to church because this is Sunday afternoon. I said, I'm going to go to church. I'm going to sing the songs. I'm going to sing them to you. I'm going to try to relate to what the words are saying. I'm going to pray, believing that you hear me. I'm going to go to the church, even though there's like 800-900 people in the auditorium. I said, it's just me and you. That preacher is going to say to me what you want me to know. It's just between you and me. And I said, Lord, I need to hear from you. I want to hear from you. Instruct me. I said, if you'll make yourself real to me, I'll live for you for the rest of my life. I'll do whatever you want. I'll go anywhere you want me to go. I said, but if you don't make yourself real to me, I'm just going to continue on, get my engineering degree, get my house in the country, get my two cars in the driveway, get my pool in the backyard, and have my nice little family in America. Yeah. And little pause. I've got a house in the country. I got more than two cars in the driveway, and I thank God I don't have a pool in the backyard. All right, that's a lot of maintenance. I learned that when I was young. But back to the story. So here I am. I'm reading the Bible. I'm praying. I'm going to my class. I go to church Sunday night, and the Lord is speaking to my heart. Monday morning, I wake up. I'm spending time with the Lord. I go to class, and I said, I'm not here to learn all the chemistry and the math. I said, I want to see you. I want to see God in my physics class. I want to see God in my math class. Because God's God of order. God's the one, you know, this is discovering God. Yeah. And I said, I want you. I go back to my room and I'm reading my Bible. I'm praying. I'm reading Chick's materials. And I'm telling you, on Tuesday, I had one of the big cartoons that Chick wrote. And I got to that picture where Christ was hanging on the cross. It's a full page picture. I couldn't get past it. I could not get past it. I wept. God came on me so mightily. The peace of God, the contentment, the joy, God surrounded me. And I truly was in a place of worship. To be able to be in that place was phenomenal. I was in awe of God, His love, His forgiveness, His tenderness. I didn't want to leave. I just sat there, and I was on my face. I was in awe of God. I just wanted Him, and I got Him. Yeah. I've said it many times that if you could get born again, yeah. I did. You can't. All right, once saved, always saved. But my relationship with God was so renewed, it was like the day I got saved. My sins were gone. The guilt for my sin was gone. My relationship was new and fresh. I had a joy of God. I had a reason to smile. I had a spring in my step. I had a reason to sing and to listen to the songs of God and to put away the abominable things that God was telling me, put it away. Don't do that. Yeah. I like what Brother Jones says often. He says, why does God tell me not to do that, but not you? Yeah. Yeah. Why can you do that? God told me not to do that. Why does God allow you to do that, but it doesn't allow me to do that? He told me not to do that. Doesn't He talk to you at all? Verse 12, and they entered into a covenant to seek the Lord God of their fathers with all their heart and with all their soul. How about that? There's a covenant. I made a promise. I made a promise. I'd do whatever God wanted me to do. This is my freshman year of college. And the Lord changed me. And I did 4 years of college. I stayed there went to college, and God protected me. I never, never, Brother Bob, never was asked one time to go apart to a party. I was never offered any drugs, never was solicited with anything that was wicked. This book right here protected me.
Yeah.
God protected me. I made a choice. I'm carrying my Bible everywhere I go.
That's what, yep.
It stayed right on the desk in all my classes. I carried it with me. All that trouble stayed away. I didn't have to say no. I never had the choice.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Yeah.
Thank God. What protection. What? I mean, God fenced me in. And to go 4 years on a state campus, living on campus, which I don't recommend for anybody.
Yeah.
And yet God protected me. And I, the greatest day of my life is when I got saved. The greatest experience of my life is when I was in the first time really in awe of God. Awe of his presence. Chapter 16. 2 Chronicles chapter 16 and verse 9. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward him. The best that I knew, the best way I knew how, I just gave him my heart. I gave him my desires. He became the desire of my heart. He became my life. He became everything I wanted. And I can praise the Lord. I've never been high, never been drunk, never had a buzz, never had any of that stuff that the world, you know, seeks after and goes after every single weekend. And sometimes more than that. But that's all they can go after. But I'm addicted to God.
Amen.
I'm addicted to his presence. I'm addicted to his moving. I want it. I'm always looking for it. I'm telling you, there's nothing like it. I can't tell you what it is out there, but I believe that the devil tries to mask up everything that God is. He's a counterfeit. The devil's an absolute counterfeit. And everything that's out there is a cheap knockoff of what God has.
Yes.
And it's like, get to know God. Fall in love with him. And Psalm 34. The greatest testimony in life. Psalm 34. One of the great experiences that I had in college, being able to start a Brockport Bible study, being able to witness and testify, hand out gospel tracts there on campus, having a Bible study time, having my room, my college dorm room was filled with people. It was awesome. And people standing in the hallway listening and seeing people get saved. I know of one girl who got saved there, and her parents ended up getting divorced. And I honestly, I don't remember if this was spring semester or what, but she's at college, her parents get divorced, and they both move away from the house that she was raised in. And I remember walking with her to class, and she is crying. She's like, I don't even know where I'm going when I go home. I don't know. She goes, I don't even know where they live. And she felt so abandoned by her parents. This girl got saved. She's a preacher's wife today.
Amen.
She ended up going to Brother Vineyards. Her dad moved down to Oklahoma City. She went down to Brother Vineyards during one of his missions conferences. She is down there on spring break, and she says, hey, Dad, can I go to that church over there? He goes, no way, you ain't going to church. And she goes, oh, okay. She goes, Dad, can I go out with my friends? Yeah, sure, go ahead. So she went with her friends to church, and she ended up feeling the call of the Lord at the missions conference with Brother Vineyard. And she gave herself to the Lord, and she's a preacher's wife today. And what a blessing, you know, to see what God is able to do. And, you know, In Psalm 34:18, the Bible says, "The Lord is nigh unto them that are of a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit." This is what God's looking for. And there are people who have a broken heart. There are many people in our world, in our life, that they have a broken heart. And they don't know what to do. They don't know who to turn to. They're afraid of religion. Most are. And yet some, they don't know what else to do, so they do get involved in religion. They get confused by the dogma, and they get confused by the externals of religion. And they never get introduced to a relationship with the God of heaven. And yet God wants to use us. You remember the story of Cornelius? He's a good man. The Bible says he was a good man. And he is so good, an angel talked to him. And the angel didn't give him the gospel story. No, he says, go get this guy. Go talk to him. I mean, you get a heavenly vision, you got to go talk to some guy? Come on. You know? But God wants to use you and me to be able to tell others about him. What a blessing. And we have the privilege to be able to see people get saved. I don't know about you, but that just flips my switch. Yeah. When I see somebody get saved, yeah, and I see it happen, yeah, you know, there's some people I wonder, but when the Spirit of God confirms in my spirit they're saved, yeah, woo, man, I'm excited. I go home and I'm like, oh, guess what happened today? And I love it. I mean, that just keeps me going. I'm looking for it. Are you looking for it? There's people seeking the Lord, just like Cornelius. And God wants us to talk to them. There's people seeking the Lord. And what does the Bible say? The Bible says that if we seek him, we'll find him. Well, they're seeking him. If we keep our mouths shut, God can't use us to be an answer to their prayer. As you're turning to Romans 10:13, you probably already have that memorized. Hope your Bible is dark, got dark edges on that page, smudge marks. But I remember one time I was witnessing to a guy, and in my bus route, I'm out there, I'm following up some old addresses, and so I'm knocking on this door, nobody's home. Across the street, all these wild banshees are running around, screaming, and music's loud. And the Lord spoke to me and says, go over there. This is my last door I'm going to knock on. I've got work to do. I got things to do. I got to get ready for Sunday. And I'm knocking on this door. Nobody's there. And the Lord says, go over there. I didn't go. And so... I go on down the road. Sunday morning, we were coming up this one street, pick up a family, and some of their friends come on. Oh, this is great. We got new kids on the bus. Awesome. And so the kids get on the bus, and they're wild. They're crazy, uncontrolled, no character, no good discipline at all in their life. And they're having a time at church. So now we're taking them home, and they ask me, Pastor B.A., can you drop me off at my house instead of where you picked me up? I go, well, where do you live? I live on South Park. I said, oh, yeah, we're going right that way. I said, which house? Where do you think? The very house that God told me to go to. I felt I was on holy ground. I was like, God wants to do something with this family. This is absolutely supernatural. This is divine. And I say, and God, okay, I got it. And so I zeroed in on this house. And I went back there, and I went back there, and I went back there. And the father and the mother were an absolute mess. I mean, the whole family is a mess. And I remember going in there on Christmas Day. We were taking gifts. We decided we're going to take some presents over to these kids, and we set it up with the parents. We're going to come in. Now, my family, you see how we dress. We go into this family, and if you have a typical bus family in your mind, the extreme, okay, this was it. This was the family. And so we go in, and we're sitting down, and my kids are all sitting there looking around like, this is wild. And you can't hold a conversation. They can't speak in complete sentences. And they're yelling and screaming at each other from one room to the other. Here we are. They know we're coming. We're giving them gifts. And they're just running around, yelling and screaming, swearing and cursing. And then, all of a sudden, this guy's mother comes walking with his sister. And they introduce us real quick. And she's swearing. I mean, she's making her son look like a third grader in his swearing ability. And I'm like, oh, I guess I see where he gets it from. And so then I just kept working on him. And one day I get over there, and like I said, this is the way it is every day, all day. No, I'm not being extreme. I'm not exaggerating. I can barely stay in the house for 5 minutes. It's just so loud. And so then I take the father. I said, come out to my truck. It's finally quiet. So I start talking to him, you know, making short conversation, trying to find out where he's at. And he tells me, yeah, I've been praying. I said, yeah, where you been going? He goes, I go to that big church over there. It's the largest church building in Western New York. It's a Catholic church building that people travel the world to come and see. It's, you know, he says he goes in there and prays. I said, really? I said, who do you pray to? And he looked at me like, huh, I don't know. I guess anybody who would listen. I said, well, I'm here to answer your prayer. God sent me to answer your prayer. How else can you explain it? God told me to go there. I didn't. His kids ride the bus anyway. I drop them off at home. God's doing something. Right there, the guy got saved. His family started coming to church. I know the one daughter got saved. A drastic change. The others, I wonder. The wife, I wonder. But the whole family was coming to church. They sat under Brother Keenan's preaching all week long. Came to family conference. What a drastic change. Unfortunately, they're not doing well today. But, hey, you know, the guy did stop at my repair shop. And we hugged each other. And, you know, it's still good fellowship. You know? And what a change. You know, Romans 10:13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That's where it's at. Had a guy at work. I just hired a new guy. And prayed for him. I'm praying. I don't know if he's saved. I don't think he is. And he's been around for a while. I've taken him to summer camp when he was a teenager. And now he's working for me. I was telling you about this. He says to me the other day, he goes, can I ask you a personal question? I go, yeah. He says, does God really forgive all sin? I had the opportunity to talk with him. I'm looking forward to more. I'm looking forward to him getting saved. Is it just coincidence that he's working for me? Is it just coincidence that the guilt for sin is on him, and he can feel it? You know? What a blessing. What a day. What a day. The greatest day of my life was when I got saved. The greatest experience in my life was when I finally found out what it was to be in worship of God, to be in awe of God. What a testimony to be able to share with others. I give people my testimony all the time. I've got so many people in my church that are able to tell you the day I got saved, all right? And because I say it often. And I like people knowing that I know when I got saved. Now, does it mean that you're not saved if you don't know the day? No. All right. Paul says, it was at noon.
Yeah.
It was at noon. I know when I got saved. He doesn't give an exact date, but he says it was at noon. You know, as I am the guy who everybody talks to when it comes to baptism at church, I ask people, hey, when did you get saved? And I always grill them on their salvation. And because if I don't feel that they're saved, I'm not baptizing them. But it's like, hey, when did you get saved? And they're like, well, I don't know the exact date. I said, give me an idea. Well, it was during this meeting. It was at this time. Now we got something we can narrow it down. I said, you're able to pinpoint an opportunity, a time in your life when the Lord spoke to you. It's not just, I've always been. I don't want to hear that.
No.
I've always been saved. No, you haven't. But what a testimony to see other people get saved. Have you ever had that opportunity? Have you seen somebody get saved? Has the Lord used you to lead someone to Him, and you've seen their life transformed and see great things happen? Man, it's awesome. There's nothing to be compared in this Christian life to seeing somebody getting saved. Let's get out there. Let's be a witness for Jesus Christ. He's worthy. And if we don't do it, who will? Who else is going to do it in our circle, in the realm of life that we live? If we're not the ones to speak up, who's going to? Who's going to do it? God has us where we're at for such a time as this. There's somebody in our life that's seeking the Lord. There's somebody there. What we ought to do is pray and say, Lord, who's seeking you? Lead me to them. Use me today to be an answer to their prayer. Talk about feeling holy. Talk about feeling used of God. Talk about being involved in a divine appointment. Somebody is seeking the Lord, and God wants to use us to bring them, to witness to them, to testify of God's grace in our life, to give them our experience with God. And I'd see them trust in the Lord Jesus Christ through the knowledge of the Scriptures. God loves them and wants them. Man, what an experience. Let's tell our story and be joyful about it. Do you get excited about the day you got saved? Do you get excited about, you know, that experience? Man, I know what God did for me.
Yeah.
And, you know, and I give my dad's experience. You know, it's got some young people in here. I give my dad's testimony. I don't know what it's like to be a drunk. I don't know what it's like to use drugs, thank the Lord.
Amen.
I see the ravages. I see the consequences. I deal with the families who are pulled apart because of it. And I'm able to give testimony of what God's done in my family in bringing in salvation and taking out the drugs, taking out the booze. And it's like, that's testimony. That's a God-given testimony. Let's tell our story and be joyful about it, because people will listen to those who are excited about what they have to talk about.
Yep.
And you know, and it's like, you may be around some people who are like, I don't want to listen. Somebody else is listening.
That's right.
I'm telling you, I don't know how many times. And when I try to be, I try to see what's going on around me,
yeah.
You know. My wife doesn't think I do, but I try to see what's going on around me, and I see things going on, and I see people are listening, so I speak up a little louder. Give the gospel. I'm telling you, let's seek the Lord and get a testimony that we can share with others. That's what it's all about. That's why we're here. God didn't just save you so that you can live life and then go to heaven. He saved you so that somebody else can get saved also. Let's propagate this thing. You know, let's see people get saved. And somebody needs you. Let's be that friend. You know, a lot of times we're looking for somebody to be our friend. That's what they're looking for. We can be that friend. We can be used of God to be that friend and be able to see them come to church, see them added to the church, see them growing in the grace and the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, what did Peter do? Hey, Andrew, come and see what I see. Come and hear what I hear. That's all we got to do. And God will use us. What a blessing. What a testimony. What a life to be able to share it with others. It is phenomenal. And that's what's going to renew your spirit within you to go and see others get added to the faith. It's when you can see God doing it through you. Our Father, we thank you so very much for giving us a reason to be happy, to be excited, to be able to live the Christian life, to be able to have a joy in our heart, to be able to express it to others and not to keep it to ourselves. Lord, I pray that you would lead us to those who are seeking you. Lord, I know there are people that want you. They want the truth. They want to get away from the life that they have that's been given to them. Lord, they're tired with the baggage that they have to carry. They're burdened under the guilt of sin. And they need to know you. And I pray that you would lead us to them, that we'd be able to testify of your grace and the great things that you've done in our life, that we'd be able to invite them to church. We'd be able to see them growing in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ. Lord, I just think of so many people who came one time, got saved, and it took years before they got involved in the church of God. But Lord, I know that you're working in hearts, and I pray that you continue to woo them and draw them and make us a lighthouse in the life that you have us living, in the places that we go. Oh, that the name of Jesus Christ would be uplifted and glorified, and we'd be able to see you drawing all men unto yourself. Use us as you will. Bless this great church. Thank you for their faithfulness. Thank you for the Nagalskis. Lord, I pray that your hand of blessing would be on them. Give them strength. Give them health. And may the power of God rest upon them in a great way. In Jesus' name I pray.